Welcome to the church at Highland Park, our weekly worship service. I'm glad that you could be here with us today, and I hope for each one of you that you are able to open your hearts and your minds to hear the message of God spoken to us through word, through prayer, through music. And I'm grateful this morning for our minister to youth and outreach, Masyn, Evans-Clements, for her preaching this morning. May each one of you be touched by the way she proclaims the gospel this morning. Thank you again for being with us.
Good morning, friends. Today, we're going to talk about patience. How many of you have ever wanted something right away? Maybe you wanted dessert before dinner, or your vacation to come quicker, or your mom to drop what she's doing and come help you right now. It can be hard to be patient when we want things our way, but we don't always get our way. Just like we have to wait for our mom to help us or to eat dinner before dessert, sometimes we have to wait for God too. When we say a prayer, it doesn't mean that God's going to answer it right away. God answers prayers when he is supposed to answer them, not when we want him to. We have to remember that he knows more than we do, and he knows the best time to answer our prayers. Our job is to be patient until then and keep remembering that God loves us and knows what's best for us. Let's pray. Lord, it can be hard to be patient. Please help us remember that you know what we need and when we need it. Thank you for taking care of us and loving us even when we try to make things happen when we want them to. Amen.
Sky is clear and red.
As we join in to this time of prayer, I encourage you to remember those in our own community, our own families who are in need of our prayer, those who are taking care of the sick, and those who are suffering in other ways in our world, those who are living in fear, those who are living in confusion and hatred. May we all seek to find ways to share love. Let's pray together. Creator God, we come to you this morning thankful for your presence in our daily life. We thank you that we can look around and see so many different ways that your hand has been in our life. Pray today as we once again are worshiping together from a distance, that each one within the sound of my voice can feel that they are not alone, that together we are one body of Christ, and that your love works in and through us. May we each seek ways to share your love in our world, in every way, in every area of our life. May we seek your guidance, your direction. In your name I pray. Amen.
Good morning, Highland Park. If you're interested in giving to the church this week, there are three different ways you can do so. One, you can mail a check to the church at Highland Park at 5206 Balcones Drive, Austin, Texas, 78731. You can also go on PayPal and send to HPBC Office at hpbcaustin.org. Finally, you can go on our website and give through the website itself at hpbcaustin.org.
Now, Sarah, Abraham's wife, bore him no children. She had an Egyptian slave girl whose name was Hagar. And Sarah said to Abram, "You see that the Lord has prevented me from bearing children. Go in to my slave girl. It may be that I shall obtain children by her." And Abram had lived 10 years in the land of Canaan. Sarai, Abram's wife, took Hagar, the Egyptian, her slave girl, and gave her to her husband Abram as a wife. He went in to Hagar, and she conceived. And when she saw that she had conceived, she looked with contempt on his mistress. Then Sarai said to Abram, "May the wrong done to me be on you. I gave my slave girl to your embrace, and when she saw that she had conceived, she looked at me, on me with contempt. May the Lord judge between you and me." But Abram said to Sarai, "Your slave girl is in your power. Do to her as you please." Then Sarai dealt harshly with her, and she ran away from her. The angel of the Lord found her by a spring of water in the wilderness, the spring on the way to Shur. And he said, "Hagar, slave girl of Sarai, where have you come from, and where are you going?" She said, "I am running away from my mistress, Sarai." The angel of the Lord said to her, "Return to your mistress and submit to her." The angel of the Lord also said to her, "I will so gently multiply your offspring that they cannot be counted for multitude." And the angel of the Lord said to her, "Now you have conceived and shall bear a son. You shall call him Ishmael, for the Lord has given heed to your affliction. He shall be a wild ass of a man, with his hand against everyone and everyone's hand against him, and he shall live at odds with all his kin. So she named the Lord who spoke to her, "You are El Roi." And she said, "Have I really seen God and remained alive after seeing him?" Therefore, the well was called Berlahara. It lies between Kadesh and Bered. Hagar bore Abram a son, and Abram named his son, whom Hagar bore, Ishmael. Abram was 86 years old when Hagar bore Ishmael. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Genesis 16, or the story of the birth and conception of Ishmael, is born out of a very familiar concept to us in our world right now. Conflict. Tension. A conflict between Sarah and her slave Hagar, between Sarah, Abraham, and God, and conflict between Sarah and her very own empty womb. This passage has often been mischaracterized as a catfight between Sarah and Hagar, a battle of wills. But I think there might be a more nuanced reading of this text. Perhaps there is more at play here that we can think about today. So I invite you to use your imaginations with me today. So at the beginning of Genesis, we're thinking about the beginning of the big things, of the world, sunlight, rushing waters, the air we breathe, and the grass that we walk on, and animals, the beginning of humankind and its relationship to the world, God, and sin. It's based on mythological characters and simple characters that beg us to see parts of ourselves in their stories. But when we get to Abraham, we must start to reframe our reading of the text. This is no longer about the big things or the generalities, such as the start of the world and creation, but specificity. We're talking about a specific family in a specific geographic and social location. Now we have multifaceted characters who have real problems, real hopes, and desires. We have characters who are seeking connection with God, even though they aren't completely sure yet what it means to be in relationship with God. And it's from this overarching story about Abraham that we get at least three major religions. The conflict in this story starts not with Sarah and Abraham's struggle with infertility, though that definitely would have been a problem for them. But actually, it starts in the gap between God's promise and the fulfillment of that promise. Because in God's covenant with Abraham, God promised he would have many descendants, so many, in fact, that he would not even be able to count them. The conflict starts because God has seemingly promised them the impossible. They're quite old already, and him and Sarah have been struggling with this for years. They believe God will be faithful to Abraham's covenant, but they just don't know what that will look like because of their lived experience with infertility. As much as there is a stigma on childlessness and infertility now, it was exponentially worse in their time. Sarah's worth as a person and a wife all hinged on her ability to bear children and to bring into the world a beautiful baby boy that would inherit everything they had and carry on their legacy, not to mention to carry on his back the covenant God had made with Abraham. But for one reason or another, Sarah had not been able to conceive. And with that reality came the stinging presence of shame. It was within that shame that Sarah likely started to doubt herself. After so many years without results and watching her body age past the threshold of worthiness in her culture, she probably started to think, perhaps God hasn't included me in this covenant with Abraham. After all, God made the promise to Abraham, and it hasn't explicitly named me as mother to this child. And we could think of her famous next move as selfish or even impatient. But what I think is far more likely is after all that time, she decided that there must be something they were missing. Maybe God was requiring some creativity from them. In her search for a resolution, she decided to include her young female slave Hagar, whom they had acquired during their time in Egypt. Now, it wasn't unusual for oppressed people in their countries to leave with foreigners to have a chance at a better life. And it certainly wasn't unusual for female slaves to be given to their male masters to produce heirs in the case that the mistress of the household was not able to provide them. And in the case that this is required, Hagar's child would legally become her mistress's at their birth. So perhaps the strategy wasn't impatience or selfishness, but an act of desperation and self-sacrifice to be sure Abraham's covenant came to pass. It was an act of employing her own human agency to take part in God's purposes for them. Sarah believed God had chosen to render her barren, and so she probably believed it must be true that she should partake in a common cultural practice and give Hagar to Abraham to perform this duty. The young Hagar, on the other hand, did not have a choice in whether she would bear the son of Abraham, as she was a slave with no social standing and no rights. This covenant-bearing responsibility is given her without any permission. Abraham and Hagar conceived, and surely Sarah must have been burning with envy. Because of the social status and pride that came with having a child, it seems this might have gotten to Hagar's head a little bit. At least Sarah seemed to think so. Because just as she has been oppressed as a slave, she now looks upon Sarah with contempt. She is the bearer of Abraham's only heir, something Sarah herself couldn't do. So it felt to Sarah as if Hagar was rising up to replace her in the social order, making Sarah the possession with no rights. This infuriated Sarah so much that she blames Abraham as the patriarch of the household for Hagar's insolence. And while Abraham's voice has been solid and decisive in earlier texts, his response in verse 6 are the only words he speaks in the whole chapter, but they're the catalyst for what comes next. In appeasing Sarah and absolving himself of any responsibility as the cultural head of household, he says, "Your slave girl is in your power. Do to her as you please." And these words must have empowered Sarah as Abraham re-established her as his primary and authoritative wife, because she deals with Hagar so harshly and treats her so poorly that Hagar believes it better to escape into the wilderness and try to return home to Egypt than to continue living in their household. Hagar ran away. And when I say ran, I probably mean waddled. I think of this woman traveling through the wilderness, very pregnant, waddling with her hand on her back to support her enormous belly. I imagine she was probably sweating profusely, regardless of the temperature, and probably stopped frequently for bathroom breaks and to catch her breath. She came to a well on her path and took a break from the long journey. I imagine Hagar, as she sat at this well, questioned, why had she abandoned the relative security of Abraham's household? Why had she looked on Sarah with contempt in the first place? Why did she come to the wilderness to have her child? What was her plan? And it must have been at this crossroads of exhaustion and doubt that the Lord appeared before her. God knows Hagar, and God demonstrates this by calling her by name and being able to place her in her social location, a slave. Sarah's slave. God asks her where she has come from and where she is going, as though God has not already shown that God probably knows all of that. And in doing so, God positions God's self to listen to Hagar and allows her to talk about what she's going through. Surely, she lamented, this was never a part of God's covenant. Certainly, God hadn't planned for Sarah to treat her so poorly and for Hagar to run away and give birth in the wilderness, right? And God sees Hagar and looks on her with compassion. God sees the pain, the exhaustion, the struggle, and makes her the bearer of her own promise. And it's reminiscent of the promise made to Abraham. She is conceived and will bear a son, an heir, who has a relationship with the wilderness in which Hagar sits at this very moment. He will be a wild ass of a man, a free man, born of a slave mother. She will have many offspring because of Ishmael. And in the wilderness, at the well, she understands God has seen and acknowledged her afflictions. Unlike Sarah, God has dealt with her kindly, and she names God, something that no one else in the Old Testament does. She names God El Roy, or the God who sees. And the well at which she sat, she named the well of the living one who sees me. And by the time she returns home, Abraham must have understood the significance of her communion with God in the wilderness, because he names the child Ishmael, as Hagar was commanded. Now, at first, this story was likely told as an explanation for the origins of the Ishmaelite people and where a certain well got its name, but does it not hold truth all the same? Our God is a God who sees us, wants to hear our stories, and chooses to bring us into God's promises. But what does that look like? Hagar is not a part of the chosen people, but instead was actually property of the chosen people. But she realizes God has seen her, not only physically as she sat in the wilderness, but also emotionally. God acknowledges her pain, gives heed to her afflictions, and recognizes the social and cultural factors at play in her decisions to leave. And like I said earlier, the mainstream interpretation of this story has been that this was a catfight between two women, maybe because of arrogance or maybe because they didn't want to share their man. But I think a nuanced and careful reading of the text reveals the power structures at play in their household over against the cultural definers of femininity and worth. While the two women fought for one spot at the table in a world that struggled to see their value, God set up a whole new table full of empty chairs. And when they sat down, they realized God was inviting each of them to play a specific role in furthering God's purposes. Perhaps Sarah was onto something. Maybe, as created in God's image, instead of asking, when will God fulfill God's promises, we must ask ourselves, how, as a creative vessel filled with the gifts from the same God and as the hands and feet of Christ, how can I fulfill these promises in my community? God wants to bring us into God's promises, but I think we need to figure out where our chair is and sit down. Like Sarah, we can be mistaken about our role or lack of a role in the process, or like Hagar, we can be given a massive role that we never asked for and didn't want in the first place. And they were both bearers of a divine promise. But this story is part of the process of figuring out what that means. Perhaps, like Hagar, we are in the wilderness right now, at the crossroads of exhaustion and doubt. And I am certain God sees us today. We are struggling as a people. We are hurting for justice, for righteousness, for peace. But I think we might all have our roles mixed up, and we may all be fighting for the wrong seats at the wrong tables. Maybe your place isn't in leading the charge against racism or violence. Perhaps it's sitting back and listening to what people of color have to say about their lived experiences. Maybe your role is concern for your neighbor in response to all the political, economic, and health-related strife that pervades our communities. Maybe our role is raising children that love a little better than we do, running a nonprofit that cares for the oppressed, or maybe preaching a sermon that ruffles a few feathers and steps on a few toes. So in the conflict, what is our role right now? Maybe it's to take a deeper look within and re-examine the ways God might be calling us into God's purposes for the world through connecting with the world around us rather than detaching from our neighbor's pain and looking heavenward. Perhaps we are the carriers of this divine responsibility. So find your chair and pull up to the table. Amen. Today is the first Sunday of the month, so that means it's Communion Sunday. I encourage you, if you don't have bread or something similar or your drink, I'd encourage you to pause for just 1 second and go and get those things so that you can participate. Communion calls us to remembrance. To remember our embodied nature, which relies on the sustenance of bread and drink, and to remember Christ's sacrifice in our life in Christ. When Jesus took his disciples to the upper room, he called them to future remembrance, a time in which he would no longer be with them. And today we get to be a part of that calling. So today, with your bread and drink, remember Jesus's body broken for you and Jesus's blood shed for you. Eat and drink. Amen. Thank you for being with us virtually today as we worshiped with one another in spirit. I pray you go forward in your week and begin your search for your place at the table of God. Amen.